So, Friedrich, we are starting our trip in a couple of days, and when I was doing some research, I came across your installations. I wanted to ask you, how come you became interested in Danube?
Yeah, basically my background is a rock musician. I studied jazz and I went to India to study Indian music. When I went to India, I became more aware of sounds. I started listening to the Danube River and I got interested in this natural environments and this different quality. So when I went along the Danube River and recorded the different sounds, I understood there are different qualities that made me react in a different way, that all the sounds we hear constantly when we live close to a river, close to water, it's not just the sound of water, it could be the sound of the city you're living in, it could be the sounds of nature, of animals, it could be the sounds of the songs people have been writing, living along the Danube River, they've been writing about all that. A river is very important. It's like a being. You have more respect for a river. You understand what a river has to give or contributes to us as human beings, not just providing water, but also basically providing life.
Sama atmosfera, kako da kažem, pre toga u Beogradu, krajem 70-ih, ti nigde nisi mogao da izađeš. Postojala je šansa I postojali su klubovi raznih, mislim, govorimo o kasnom izlasku noću, kad sam ja, ne znam, vreme, kad sam studirao od 76. do 80. 80. neke. Tek su prvi kafići, ala Zlatni papagaj, počeli se otvaraju 80. A mi smo to prezirali, a Zlatni papagaj je bio ono kao što je Gile u pesmi opeo. Grozno nešto kao snobera I nešto sa tu. Ali inače si mogao, Šaper I ja smo recimo, koji smo, pošto smo se u to doba bili nerazdvojeni, družili se još iz gimnazije, mi smo najčešće sedeli u Moskvi, u hotelu Moskvi, tamo u Moskva gde je svirao penzionerski orkestar. Ne zato što sad specijalno smo volili, nego nismo imali gde da idemo, ono bukvalno. I onda si tu sedao, oni su se do 11, pola, 12 radili, onda je bila šansa I Malo, pa mi neka tuča nastala u šanci, recimo, pošto je šanci radio do 5 ujutru, onda su imali pauzu do pola 6, da se srede I opet je nastavio. Tako da nisi baš imao gde mnogo da ideš, niti je bilo to mnogo romantično zapravo. Možda nas je to nateralo onda I ta nekakva čitava, ta prva serija čuvenih beogradskih žurki je nastala zbog, verovatno, iz čemera I jada, pošto nisi ljudi imali gde da idu. Sećam se, ono, recimo, zabavljam se, s takom devojkom tadašnjom mojom I pičimo zimi, ono, bez para, ne možeš da ideš u kafanu, ali te teraju da jedeš, ono, opet jedva da imamo pare za piće, ali to, mislim, ono, zima, stanovi mali, socijalistički, roditelji tu, nemaš gde da ideš, mislim, ono, tako da, ovaj... Elem, onda je došao taj, to proleće... We'll be right back.
Definitely inspiring always if there is a river nearby or water nearby. For me it's very important because if you feel a bit empty, you can go to the river, you can look at it, you can just be nearby and it fills you up with energy. Or if sometimes if you want to feel empty because you are full of everything, it calms you down. So you can get always the energy you want from it. Nobody cares for him. Nobody cares for him. What a good audience. Full of self-confidence. So I
I
art is comes closer and closer. It's not something that, okay, I go to see an exhibition and it's far. Okay, I go to theater, but that's a very big event. It comes close to the people because they start to use original places, not this typical theater spaces. It's happening. And it's here, I'm sure if we would start walking that way, we would find something on the street which is a piece of art. And also we can go somewhere and we can use the space. So it's, I'm optimistic about it and I like what is going on here.
Martin Roy mal od detstva vášnivo rád mapy. Celé hodiny sa vydržal pozerať na nakreslenú Európu alebo Afriku a z objaviteľského dobrodružstva sa mu krútila hlava. Každá krajina mala inú farbu. Červenú, hnedú, zelenú a vody modrú. Mučila ho túžba po všetkom vzdialenom. Prstom chodil po neprebádaných končinách a keď uvidel nejakú, ktorá vyzerala zvlášť vábivo, zapichol do nej prst a povedal, keď vyrastiem, pôjdem tam. Predovšetkým sa však na mape vtiahla rieka. Dunaj pripomínala dlhočizného hada s hlavou v Čiernom mori, s telom rozloženým cez celý kontinent a s úzkým chvostom, ktorý sa strácal v Čiernom lese. Rieka ho fascinovala ako had vtáka. Tam sa musí dostať. Ten had ho už vtedy hypnotizoval a neprestal dodnes. As a child here, you were always somehow close to the river, but for very, very long time, Bratislava lived in a way distant, in a sort of distance to river, because you can see everywhere that there was this way of protecting from the high water and flooding, and people did not really interconnected with the river. And so that was what I was for a long time considering when I was writing this project, because as you see, Bratislava is a place on the border. You are here just this way in 5 kilometers, you are already in Austria. You go the other way, this way, and you are in 9 kilometers in Hungary. And this position was actually created by Danube as well. And Danube always was dividing this part of the world, so to say, the Slavic world on the east and the Germanic world, the German-speaking world to the west. Or, you know, even the Romans already had this river as a point to divide the barbarian Europe from the civilized Europe. So there are so many points where you can get inspired by, and from the history of Danube, from the way how it is today. And for me, it was a challenge because when you look at it, you think like Danube is so long river, you know, and there are so many people living by the river. That, you know, how you decide to make it your own, you know, how you going to try to interpret this mass of information. So that's why I chose one ship, one trip, 20 days, one river cruise, like two young people and 120 very old, very spoiled, very rich American people. And I used this, so to say, contrast between how Americans see this part of the world and how this young gentleman, young guy, how he is trying to present his world, his countries, his cultures to these foreigners who have no idea about where they are, what are they doing here, and basically want to get to know this place. And this was, so to say, my way how to make it easier for myself and how to make a story really happen. And we, you know, we stand here on a bridge which is called Most Senepa, which is the bridge of the Slovak national uprising to commemorate. This was called the structure, the building of the century, of the 20th century, by the architects in such a sort of competition. But it's I love this bridge in many ways, and it changed the face of the city. But on the other hand, it completely destroyed the Jewish part of the old Jewish part of Bratislava, and also the synagogues. And what it's a paradox, because this whole part under the Bratislava Castle, it survived the Second World War and the Nazi occupation, but it did not survive the Stalinism. It was in the late 50s when they started, because of the bridge, to remove all these over 4,000 houses were destroyed to build this huge structure. So you see the history of Danube in Bratislava was for many times very violent and very devastating one. And this is something you can get inspired by.
Običan uvid, ovde živim već 11 godina i osjećam se prilično domaćim, a istovremeno sam i stranac, pošto postoji taj određeni komunikacijski problem ponekad. Tako da sve skupa daje mi jedan dosta zanimljiv ugao na posmatranje života. A i takođe, sama činjenica da je Beč 600 km udaljen od Beograda je, ili recimo 400 kod Zagreba ili Ljubljane i sve to mi daje puno slobode, da tako kažemo, pošto je to zaista region, kako se često zove, i Beč je uvek i bio na neki način politički centar čitavog regiona, jer hteli mi to ili ne, to je negde prvi ozbiljen organizovani grad koji nam je blizu. Tako da, recimo, u bivšoj Jugoslaviji neka veća relacija bila, ne znam, Niš-Maribor ili Niš-Ljubljana, nego Beč-Beograd. Tako da, zapravo to i nije tako daleko uopšte. A kad uzmemo u obzir da pola Beča govori srpski, mislim da, ili BKS, kako se to zove, Bozniše, Kroatiše, Serbiše, šta reći, nego živjeli. Dobro došli, prijatelji. Ja znam, šta me inspirisalo u Beču? Nešto što sam prepoznao kao staro, ima Beči nešto svoje orijentalno, kažu ono da Balkan počinje u trećem bicirku, koji je ono prvi bicirk na jug odavde. I ima neke istine u tome, i Nemci, čak Austrijance drže za polu Balkanca, oni gledaju onako malo ispod oka, tako da s jedne strane me to inspirisalo, a s druge strane ne znam, da budem iskren, ono, kao Beč je muzički grad, tu su zaista živjeli ono, neki od najvećih kompozitora svih, naravno nisam ja zbog toga u Beču, on, pošto davno umrli, ali postoji nešto, koliko god puta sam svirao u Beču, uvijek sam se dobro osjećao, ono, kao bilo s kojim bendom, bilo sa svojim, bilo sa ovim novim, bilo u nekoj trećoj kombinaciji, ne znam, bit će se duhovi u pitanju.
Light of the camera, we have to put it in. Good. Welcome to the room of darkness. We are here without light, opening a film camera where there is photosensitive material, which puts in a mechanical way the reality into pictures. Why are you doing that? Because you have to go out of yourself, of your mind, looking at something with a machinery and have like this moment of meditation in the darkness. Somehow film is also protection from outer world, because it's a weapon where you suck the light out of a situation where you act in the moment and you can't rewind, because what's there in the moment, it's now in your hand. I'm developing it, I'm processing this material which has been part of my body, my human being. I keep quiet for a second. Oh. Wait. So now I have 7.5 meters of 60 millimeter material, shot on positive material, which is really cheap one. Use it to get the positive picture after the negative. By putting through sides again to put the shadow of the shadow again to the film, so you have a positive. Good. Yeah, back to reality. Buongiorno.
Nice. Oh.
Good. Normally when I'm doing these films for this one, it takes 1.5 years, you know, for me to do, and it's only 3 minutes long, you know. And then when I'm projecting it, people sitting here, and I'm going to the bar or in the official place, going to the bar and drink some whiskey. That's the point where I'm excited, and when the people come out, I want to look at the face. That's the energy I like to have.
Diese unnötigen Fragen, was mir da bis jetzt irgendwie gestellt worden sind. Nimm mir einfach ein Buch vom Kandinsky mit dem Titel Über das Geistige in der Kunst. Kunstwerk und Künstler. Auf eine geheimnisvolle, rätselhafte, mystische Weise entsteht das wahre Kunstwerk aus dem Künstler. Von ihm losgelöst, bekommt es ein selbstständiges Leben, wird zur Persönlichkeit, zu einem selbstständigen, geistig atmenden Subjekt, welches auch ein materiell reales Leben führt, welches ein Wesen ist. Es ist also nicht eine gleichgültig und zufällig entstandene Erscheinung, die auch gleichgültig in dem geistigen Leben weilt, sondern wie jedes Wesen besitzt es weiterschaffende, aktive Kräfte. Es lebt, wirkt und ist an der Schöpfung der besprochenen geistigen Atmosphäre tätig. Also stelle ich mir die Frage, brauche ich die Malerei für mich oder nicht? Und das ist halt doch, ja, ich brauche die Malerei für mich, weil sie einen sehr, sehr, sehr intensiven Sinn für mich ergibt und das jeden Tag aufs Neue. Ne? Da ist man, jetzt am Boden zu bleiben, aber ein bisschen Gott, man schöpft, man erzählt und schafft die Welt immer wieder neu, aufs Neue, jeden Tag. Und da gibt es kein Ende, ne? Der Tod ist dann vielleicht das Ende, aber da hat man ja noch Zeit hoffentlich. Ne?
Of course, we look at the river from human perspective, and of course it's also a geological mirror, if you want to say so. You know, everything that is happening alongside the river is taken by the river in a way, and the images, the laughter and the sorrows is carried with the river. The river is changing its color all the time. its movement, its speed. It's here we have a very olive green river. My impression is that the Delta River is rather gray. You know, the Strauss brothers composed it as a blue Danube River. You know, and of course it's also a bloody river because it's a river where, you know, in recent times a lot of blood was spilled into it.
Thank you. Mm. Pivo.
Super.